Privileged to introduce an old friend of mine today. A lot of you guys know that we came from a church in Naperville, Illinois, and that was some 16 years ago. But some maybe 20 years ago or 21 years ago, I was done being the junior high pastor, and this friend of mine came and took my place and did a better job. And it was so great to have a relationship with this guy. Some 11 years ago, they went to Indonesia to be missionaries, and they are doing an amazing job. I wish I could have time to share stories about these guys, but that's his job today. Will you give a hand to Jamie Kemp as he comes to share this morning?
All right. Man, that's a long walk. All right, here we go. All right, I'm here now. All right. Man, thanks, Pastor Trev. Wow, it is great to be at Crossings Church with you guys this morning. My name is Jamie, and my wife Tasha and I and our two kids, Phoebe and Benaiah, were your missionaries to the country of Indonesia. And man, it is great. Indonesia is a tropical country. We live on the equator, and it's hot there. But it ain't hot like this. All right, man, you guys, man, this is a different kind of hot that I'm experiencing. All right, my kids have grown up in Indonesia, and so it's very humid there. It's just humid all the time. You know, we only have two seasons there, hot and hotter. That's our only two seasons there. But it's so funny to see our kids when we come back to the States. They've never really lived in America, and so they've never had chapped lips before. You know, this dryness, they're like, why are my lips so dry? You know, so we're like walking around smothering it on our faces while we're here in the States. But it's great to be with you guys, man. We're just so grateful for all these years to be connected with Crossings Church. 10 years ago, I think it was maybe 11 years ago, I came down here, and Crossings Church was one of the first churches that jumped behind us as missionaries. As we moved from suburban Chicago to the other side of the world, this was one of the first churches that said, hey, we wanna be a church that doesn't just reach our neighbors, but we also wanna be impacting the nations. And that's the kind of church you're a part of. This is the kind of church that you want to be a part of that says, man, reaching our neighborhoods are important. That this is what we need to be about, reaching those who are close to us, our family members, our friends, our neighbors, our coworkers. But as we're doing that, we realize that the kingdom of God is international and that there are nations out there waiting still to hear about Jesus. And so that's the kind of church Crossings is. That's the kind of church that you're a part of. And so we're grateful to be connected with it. So thanks, Pastor Trev and Cindy, for letting us be here this weekend and standing with us all these years. I bring greetings from Lauren Di Giambattista. If you were here a couple years ago, you might remember. She serves on our team there in Indonesia, and she is doing a great job there. So, well, are you ready for a great sermon? All right. Well, make sure you're here next week then. All right. Pastor Trev will be back in the pulpit. Today, you got me. So I'm sorry. You're going to have to kind of just suffer through what I've got to say today. So turn to the person next to you and say, Indonesia. All right. And now, most people don't even know where this country is. All right. So we better do a quick geography lesson. All right. So if we've got India right here and Australia right here, India, Australia, the 17,000 islands between India and Australia, that's the country of Indonesia. Now turn to the person next to you and say, Indonesia, as if you knew it all along, like Indonesia. Of course I know where that country is, all right? So that's the country my wife and I are missionaries to. Now here's the interesting thing about Indonesia. Indonesia is the fourth largest country in the world. I mean, most of us know about the three biggest countries in the world, right? We know that China's the biggest, the second most populous country in the world is India, the third biggest is what? Is America, right? Right here. So we're the third largest country, but the fourth largest country with over 250 million people living there is this island nation of Indonesia. So you've got all these people and all these islands there, but here's the thing that's really kind of captured our attention for the country of Indonesia. It's this. Indonesia is the largest Muslim country in the world, with over 220 million Muslims living in Indonesia alone. I mean, that's more than Iraq, Iran, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, all those Middle Eastern countries combined. So we have a huge task in front of us as your missionaries to the largest Muslim country in the world. But here's what we're believing God for. We believe that Indonesia will be the first Muslim country to come to Christ. That we're giving our life to and we're working hard to see this thing. And we believe that one of the ways this is going to happen is by reaching the next generation. And so that's what my wife and I do with our, as team leaders, this team that we lead there in Indonesia, is that we're working with Muslim university students. That we believe that, man, if we can engage this next generation, if we can reach this next generation, man, we can see this Muslim nation turn to Christ. And so that's what we're doing there. But let me give you some context of how we got to go about doing that, because like in the States where we can just kind of rent a school, right, and have a church, right? We can't just kind of roll in and say, hey, let's start a church, because for the most part, the Muslim young people are forbidden to even go into a church according to their religion. So, I mean, I remember my wife and I were talking and we're praying, we're thinking, like, how do we engage a culture that won't come to church? And so we're thinking about it, we're praying about it, and we decide, well, let's open up an English center, all right? Because you know, I'm already fluent in English, right? You know, like I speak English really good, and some of you know, all right. Some of you guys are like, yeah, that boy does speak good English. All right, so that's what we did. We started tutoring young people in English and helping them. But instead of just using English curriculum, we'd use the scriptures and the Bible as our text. And so we'd have this small group of Muslims studying the scriptures in English. And that one group turned to two groups, and it grew into four groups. And over the years now, we've got over 200 Muslim young people involved in the ministry, studying the scriptures, growing in their faith in Christ, many of them being baptized in water and committing themselves to follow Jesus. So this incredible thing is happening, and make no mistake about it, friends, you are shareholders in this. That you are a part of what God is doing on the other side of the world. And that's the great thing about being a part of a church that believes in missions, that says we're going to look beyond ourselves and see the kingdom of God established where it's never been established before. Here's what the Bible says about it in 1 Corinthians 3:6. 1 Corinthians 3:6 says this: I planted the seeds in your heart, and Apollos watered it, but it was God who made it grow. So I planted the seeds in your heart, Apollos watered it, but it was God who made it grow. So we understand the spiritual principle that some plant, some water, but God makes it grow. All right, so everyone say, some plant. Ooh, I lost some of you already. I've been only talking like 4 minutes. All right, I got to get you back. Nudge the person next to you and say, some plant. Now everybody say, some water, but God makes it grow. And that's what we're seeing in Indonesia, that God is making these seeds of faith grow, that sometimes we walk into an area where there are no Christians, there are no believers, and we're planting the seeds of faith where they've never been planted before. And sometimes we come alongside these new believers, and we're watering the seeds of faith and seeing them discipled and grow in the faith, and them starting to reach their Muslim friends. But it's God who always, always, always brings the fruit. It's God who makes it grow. And that's what we're seeing in Indonesia. So let me kind of explain of our setting there in Indonesia. Living in Indonesia, everyone I know is Muslim. Now let me explain that to you. Everyone I know is Muslim. All right, my neighbors to the left and to the right across the street. I mean, at the grocery store, everybody. But oftentimes we're the first Christians they've ever met. So it's so interesting, especially around Christmas time. I love to ask my Muslim friends. I'll say, hey, what do you know about the Christmas story? And, you know, last year I was talking to my friend Ganis, and I said, Ganis, what do you know about the Christmas story? You know, and I remember him kind of almost embarrassed. He's like, well, Jamie, I know that you put your socks above a fire. And I'm like, okay. And then he's like, and then he's all confused. He's like, is it Jesus' cousin Santa Claus that comes and like brings you guys presents? And I'm like, no. You know, and so it's just so interesting to see like how unreached and how they've never met a Christian or never seen a church or never heard the Christmas story before. And so that's what we do there in Indonesia. And I can remember when we moved there 10 years ago, and we have to start a ministry from nothing. You know, how do you move to a Muslim country and start something from nothing? And so my wife and I are thinking and we're talking, and we said, well, let's start with prayer. You know, like that's probably a good place to start. And so, but instead of praying just in our home, we decided, let's prayer walk different parts of the city and ask the Lord to introduce us to the right people. So I remember as we're prayer walking some different parts, where our prayer was this, God, give us one Christian. Could you introduce us to one believer in this city that could kind of introduce us to the culture and kind of help us adjust to our city here? And I remember we're praying this one part of the city, and 1 week goes by, and we don't meet any Christians. The second week goes by, and again, we don't meet any Christians. We're making lots of connections with Muslim young people. We're having a great time with that, but no Christians. Finally, after the third week, we meet some Christians, but none of them had a heart to reach their city for Jesus. So 4 weeks go by. Now it's been a month, 5 weeks. Finally, after 6 weeks, I meet Jose. Jose was a pharmaceutical major at one of the universities there, and he says to me, "Oh, Pastor Jamie, I've been praying that God would send somebody to the city to help me reach it for Jesus." And I'm like, "Jose, where you been? Right? You know, I've been looking for you for like 6 weeks. All right." So I finally meet Jose, and we sit down and we have coffee together, and he shares with me his heart for the city. I share my vision to help young people reach Muslims for Jesus. And he says, "Pastor Jamie, I've got these three friends. Would you mentor us and disciple us on how to be missionaries just like you?" And I'm like, "Of course I'll do that, Jose. Like that's like literally what I'm paid to do. Like, of course I'll do that, right?" And so I begin to meet with these core four. I begin to mentor and disciple them. We decide, you know what, let's begin a Bible, let's open our Bible study, and let's begin to invite our Muslim friends to join us. So we began, we met the manager at a Dunkin' Donuts street from the university there, and we rent out the back room of the Dunkin' Donuts, and we decide this next Friday night, let's invite our Muslim friends to come and study the scriptures, the Jesus of the Bible, with us. And our prayer was this, our prayer was that we would have 9 people there. All right, that was our prayer. Our miracle goal was 10, because we were like, double digits, yeah, that'd be awesome. But God, we're believing you for 9, all right? But 10 would be great. All right, so we're praying for 10, and we're inviting our friends, and we're praying, and we're asking them, inviting them to come. But it's not like America, where we could like hand out invitations or anything like that. It all had to be word of mouth. So we're praying and we're inviting, and finally that Friday night comes, and we're believing God is going to bring our friends, and that first night, 32 Muslims show up, all right? And so we're like, "Oh man, we didn't expect that. I was expecting one small group." Instead, we had divided up into 3 small groups, and at the end of the night, I stand up and I say, "Hey guys, we're going to do this again next Friday night. We'd love for you to all come back," and guess what happened? They all came back and brought friends, you know, because that next week we had 36 students show up, and they're all sitting around, and we had them all studying the scriptures. But I noticed something. None of them were ordering any coffee or donuts at the Dunkin' Donuts, and I think it's an international thing. College students are broke everywhere in the world, all right? You know, they said, "I have any money." So it must be an international thing, all right? So I talked to the manager. I'm like, "Don't worry, I'll order a coffee and a donut for everybody here." And we kind of start doing this week after week, where we've got 36 to 38, 40 young people coming every single week. Finally, we had every table taken up at that Dunkin' Donuts, and nobody could get in, and people were leaving because we just didn't have enough facilitators to make it happen. And so we moved out of that Dunkin' Donuts, and we moved to the basement of a Kentucky Fried Chicken, all right? You know, so, you know, we felt like we were kind of moving our way up. You know, we were thinking Pizza Hut was the next big move, all right? So, yeah, so we spent 3 years meeting in the basement of that Kentucky Fried Chicken until finally we opened up our own English center, where now every Friday night, 100 Muslim young people gather together to read the scriptures, to talk about them, and many of them are on their way discovering Jesus. Some of them have made that step of faith and are following Jesus. So if you've ever wondered, does my missions giving make a difference? Are my prayers really having an effect? My simple answer would be, yeah. It's having a huge effect in Indonesia. Sometimes we have to plant where nothing is going on. Sometimes we start watering those seeds, and man, God starts to make it grow. Oftentimes, we go to places in Indonesia where there are no Christians, there are no churches, they're totally unreached by the gospel. We call them unreached people groups. And it's hard for me even to put my mind around it that there are still places in this world where you can be born and go your whole life without seeing a church, meeting a Christian, or hearing about Jesus. But there's over, according to our statistics, our research, that, man, there's 100 70 million Muslims in Indonesia alone. That's 220 ethnic groups in Indonesia with 0% Christian. 0% chance of hearing about Jesus or seeing a church. They'll go their whole life without an opportunity. And this has moved us like nothing else. Like, how do we go about planting the church where there is no church? And we call this unreached people groups or never reached people groups. And this has just stirred our heart like nothing else. And I want to make a quick distinction between the lost and the unreached, okay? The lost and the unreached. The lost are all around us, right? And we all have friends and family members who don't know Jesus. And we got neighbors and co-workers that God has empowered us by His Holy Spirit to be a witness to. And so Jesus cares about the lost. Jesus cares about our family members who don't know Jesus. These are important to Him and uses us to reach them. But on my way to church this morning, I passed like four churches. So there are opportunities here in the States to hear about Jesus. You and I are here. When I talk about the unreached, what I mean is there is no chance to hear about Jesus. That there is no way that they'll go their whole life without seeing a church, meeting a Christian, or hearing about Jesus. And are we okay with that? That there are still huge pockets of Indonesia totally untouched with the gospel. And man, this is what we ought to be about as the church, about planting the church where it's never been planted. And it's hard for me even to put my mind around this in our day of technology and internet and information access, that there are still so many parts of our world that are untouched and unreached with the gospel. And oftentimes I'm asked, Jamie, why are they unreached? And my simple answer is because they're hard to reach. You know, like if they were easy to reach, someone would have reached them already. My parents, who some of you guys will get to meet this winter, I think they're going to winter here in Goodyear. My dad loves to joke around and say, Jamie, you know, don't they need a Jesus in like the Bahamas or Jamaica? You're like, we come visit you all the time. You know, why Indonesia? And so our simple answer is, well, why Indonesia? Because all the easy places have already been taken. So the only places to go to send missionaries now are the tough places, the places where there are no churches, there are no believers. And so there's two reasons really why they're unreached. The first is because they're hard to reach. Like physically, they're hard to get to. So a couple years ago, we have a church plant in the Maluku Islands. But to get to the Maluku Islands, we have to get on a flight from our city and travel 8 hours by plane to get there, to the island of Ambon. Then we will arrive in Ambon. We have to take an overnight ferry to the island of Seram. When we land in Seram, Tasha was leading this team. She had to get off the ferry and get on a little mini bus that took them 6 hours to the interior of that island. And then they got out of the mini bus and they got into the back of a dump truck and drove 2 hours up the side of a volcano to get to a village where there are no Christians. They were the first time they've ever heard about Jesus in that little village, right? And so sometimes they're unreached because they're just hard to get to, all right? And there's still two more villages up the volcano. We're going to let another missionary handle those guys, all right? So sometimes when we talk about the unreached, sometimes they're just hard to get to, that there are still places of our world that are just difficult to travel to. But the main reason why we have most of our areas of Indonesia are unreached with the gospel is they're just not accepting of the gospel. That they don't want the gospel. They're resistant to Christianity. Man, it's just so difficult that in 2,000 years, for some reason, there hasn't been enough missionary sacrifice or enough church planters to go and commit themselves, their lives, to seeing the church of Jesus established amongst those people groups. So they're just totally unreached, never reached with the gospel. And one of those people groups is an ethnic group called the Bugis. Everybody say Bugis. All right, you're still with me. Good. All right. Bugis, like the boogeyman. All right. Now, this is an ethnic group of 3 million people. Okay, so we're not talking about, oh, let's go reach this little village over here. We're talking about all of Central Sulawesi, 0% Christian. 3 million Bugis. So if you're born into a Bugis family, into the Bugis culture, you'll go your whole life without seeing a church. You'll go your whole life without meeting a Christian. You'll never hear about Christianity. You'll never hear about Jesus. Man, this has moved us like nothing else. And so we've taken trips up to that part of the country, and we've been praying, God, would you help us to reach the Bugis? Would you help us to empower an Indonesian church planter to go work? What do we got to do, God, to reach the Bugis? And one day, a young man shows up to our English center in our city, and his name is Philo. And Philo comes in. I say, hey, Philo, where are you from? He says, well, I'm from Banjar, I'm from Palopo. And I say, oh, really? Well, what's your ethnic group? And he says, I'm Bugis. I'm like, really? I've been praying for you. No, I didn't say that. He'd have been like, you're weird. All right, so, but Philo comes. A Bugis young person is studying in our city, and he comes into our English center. And Philo right away gets involved with our English community. And he starts joining one of our Bible studies. And I remember after the first Bible study he comes to, I say, hey, Philo, are you ready to follow Jesus with your life? Philo kind of laughs. He says, Jamie, you know I'm Muslim. I can't do that. I'm like, okay, no problem, Philo. We'll see you next week at Bible study. The next week, Philo comes to Bible study. And at the end of Bible study, I'm like, Philo, are you ready to follow Jesus with your life? And he laughs. Jamie, you know I'm Muslim. I can't do that. Okay, no problem. We'll see you next week at Bible study. Next week, Philo comes to Bible study. Same thing happens. Philo, are you ready to follow Jesus with your life? He's like, no, Jamie, you know I'm Muslim. I can't do this. Well, this goes on week after week, after month, after month, after year. After year. And every week, Philo comes to Bible study. And every week, I ask him the same question. Philo, are you ready to follow Jesus with your life? And every week, he gives the same answer. Jamie, you know, I'm a Muslim. I can't do that. This happens. And he always came, never confrontational, just always curious with his questions about Christianity. This goes on and on. And finally, one night, you know, I kind of ask him after Bible study, almost out of like rote memory, you know, like, Philo, are you ready to follow Jesus with your life? All right. And he kind of, and he says this to me. He says, Jamie, not yet. What? His answer changed. I remember texting all the Christians like, hey, we got to pray for Philo. His answer changed, all right? So I text them all. And so I'm praying. I think we have a picture of Philo. Can we show the picture of him and I on that airplane ride? I don't know if we have the PowerPoint. Oh, yeah, that's it, Philo right there. Okay, so that's him going on a trip with me. And so a couple days later, I'm awoken at 4 a.m. with a text message. Here's the screenshot of the text message. It says this, Jamie, I feel like I'm such a sinner, and I'm so far from God. I know that you know God. Would you help me to know God like you know God? I take my phone. I'm like, it's 4 a.m. I'll call him later. No way, right? No, I'm going to call him right now. So I text him right away, and I'm like, Philo, what do we got to do? Let's connect today. What time are you free? Come on over to our house. And later that morning, Philo comes to our house. We sit down with the scriptures, and I start walking him through the Romans road. It's kind of an old school way of sharing the gospel. And I get to this Bible verse in Romans 10:13. It says, "Barang siapa yang berseru kepada Tuhan Yesus akan diselamatkan. Anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." And I say, Philo, that word anyone, does that mean only Americans can be saved, or can an Indonesian be saved? He kind of laughs. He's like, well, of course, anyone means anyone. An Indonesian can be saved. I'm like, okay, great. I'm like, how about this? That word anyone, does that mean only a Christian can be saved? Or can a Muslim call upon the name of the Lord and be saved? And when I said that, something changed in the room. I just remember his head going down. And I could start to see his eyes start to water up and him nodding his head. Yeah. Yeah, I guess a Muslim can be saved. In that moment, I said, Philo, are you ready to call upon the name of the Lord and be saved? In one of the most emotional moments of my life, he lifts his head, tears coming down his cheeks. He says, yeah, Jamie, I'm ready to be saved. Man, and in that moment, yeah, amen, right? Guys, and in that moment, man, we prayed together, we cried, and I thought, wow, a child of Islam has been welcomed home into the family of God. A son of Ishmael has been welcomed home into the family of God. And I couldn't help but think, like, what if he's the first of all the believers of the Bugis tribe, of the Bugis ethnic group to come to Christ? What if he's the first of millions to come to Christ, all because there's a church in Crossings, at Crossings Church in Goodyear, that says we believe in looking beyond ourselves to the mission field overseas. This is what you do. There are Philos in Indonesia who are coming to Christ and impacting their nation because you believe in missions. A couple weeks later, Philo comes to me and he says, Pastor Jamie, I was reading the Bible like you told me to, and I noticed something that after someone becomes a Christian, they're supposed to be baptized in water. Can I be baptized in water? And I'm like, why didn't I think of that? You know, I'm a pastor. You know, I should have thought of that. You know? So I'm like, of course you can. All right. So we don't have a church or anything like that. That's all fancy or anything like that. So we don't have a water baptism place. So we get a giant water tank and we cut off the top of it. We fill it with water. And as Philo gets into the waters of baptism, I remember Tasha standing off to my right and her saying, Philo, we've been waiting over 2 years for this moment. Welcome home. And as he gets up out of the waters of baptism, as you can see, he couldn't even stand. I mean, I remember just holding him and him weeping with joy of the Lord, knowing that his sins are forgiven and he's on his way to heaven. That's what we do. That's what you do. Sometimes we plant the seeds of faith and we're working in places where there is no church and there is no gospel. Sometimes we water those seeds and it might take over 2 years, but at just the right time, God makes it grow. God always comes through at just the right time. And there are people in your life. There are Philos in your life, right? That, man, you've been planting those seeds of faith for years. There's family members in your life. Man, you've been watering those seeds and you're saying, God, when's it going to happen? Maybe God has brought me all the way from Indonesia to tell you, don't give up. Don't stop. Don't give up on the Philos in your life, because at just the right time, God's going to bring the increase. God's going to make it grow. I still see a lot of empty seats in this auditorium waiting for you, not for Pastor Trev or the other staff members to create some sort of program, but for you to bring that Philo here and to fill this place. Wouldn't it be awesome that by Christmas time this next year, there's a Philo sitting next to you? That family member you've been praying for, that friend, that co-worker that you're believing God for, and it's taken 2 years, but at just the right time, they're going to respond to that text message of, hey, will you come to church with me this morning? And they're actually going to say, yes, I'm ready to come. Would you stand with me this morning? I want to kind of just pray a prayer of blessing. Because in Indonesia, we're taking a giant step of faith. That we're believing in this next several years that we want to move from reaching hundreds every week to reaching thousands every week. That we're really believing, God, that the impact that we're having, the hundreds that we're ministering to every week, that in the next couple years, we're going to see it jump to thousands. So we're believing, God, to begin to multiply our work in Indonesia. And man, we need a partner in Crossings Church. Man, we need the financial support to continue the mission. So because you give, we can go. We can have stories like this with Philo. Man, because you're praying for us, we're seeing breakthroughs happen, and we're believing God to jump us from 100 to thousands. But if we're going to see that kind of growth, we also need team members to join us in Indonesia. Man, maybe you or someone you know is looking for a place to land in missions, or maybe God is stirring your heart to go and be a part of a short-term team or something longer that you'd land with us. And you'd have some stories of your own to share about Philos. So missions is our neighbors and our nations. And I want to pray that God would use you this coming semester before Christmas. One friend, one co-worker will be at Crossings Church by Christmas. Would you pray with me? Let's kind of just close our eyes to kind of just make this a moment between us and God. If you would say this morning, God, would you use me this semester, this coming year, to bring one person to Crossings, just go ahead and lift your hand, because I want to pray a prayer of blessing. I want to believe, God. Yes, I see, man, almost every hands are going up. God, you see these hands lifted. There's co-workers and friends of ours who don't know Jesus. Use them, each hand that's raised, God. I see every seat filled by Christmas, God. God, that there are people we've been praying for. God, missions is not just there, missions is here as well. So use each person, God. I'm believing for powerful things to happen at Crossings Church in good year, God. That this church is going to be a blessing to impact the city. Every hand raised to be anointed. Give them vision, God, and eyes to see those opportunities. I pray blessings on them. Use them as you've used us in Indonesia. The same power that's alive in me is the same power alive in them. I bless them today. It's the name of Jesus we pray. And everybody says together, amen, amen. Pastor Trev, go ahead and close us today.
Guys, thank you so much, Jamie. Give him a hand. Give Tasha a hand. It's one thing every month for us to, you know, update or talk about what God's doing in India or Indonesia or Mexico, but it's just really exciting to have him here today and get a view of what's going on. When you came in today, you received a couple envelopes. One of them has the flags. It's our missions envelope. And we've got the baskets in the back. So if you'd like to give today towards what's happening in Indonesia, feel free to do so. You could do it next week. Well, we know how to get money to their bank account. We've got that figured out. But I want us, when we get to heaven one day, to say that we truly were partnering with people that were changing nations. And it's really cool to have moments like this, because you realize, like, oh, there's more to this church than meets the eye. It's not just what's happening here. There's stuff happening all over the place. And I just thank God for that. Just so know this, you're a part of something cool. You're a part of something that's after God's very heart. Let's pray one more time for Jamie, Tasha, and Father, we thank you, Lord, for the Kemps. Lord, would you just bless them? Would you watch over them, God? Lord, would you be with Phoebe and Benaiah? Lord, would you just cause those kids to have everything they need and more? And God, I pray for the believers in Indonesia. Strengthen them and help them to reach out. And I pray, God, every need be met. And as we grow, Lord, help us grow with them and with our other partners around the world. Lord, I pray for those that came in here today with needs in their life that seem so big. God, would you show yourself faithful? The same God that met a Philo, Lord, would you show them that you're able to meet them today and you know their name? God, we thank you for this church. I pray you bless everyone here today as we go. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, and we will see you next week. Go in God. If we're tearing down today, so if you want to help us tear stuff down and push carts, we always love help.